are flying somewhere over the Atlantic Ocean off Norfolk, Virginia. Now ahead of us is the U.S. aircraft carrier, the America. I can't see it out this window, which is probably just as well, because if I could, it would look like a tiny little speck in the water. If we land on it successfully, and let's pray that we do, we are going to be spending the next 2 days aboard the aircraft carrier. As I said, it looks like a tiny little speck from the air, but actually it is a huge combination airport and city, plowing through the ocean at over 30 miles per hour. Over the next 2 days, we'll find out what life is like aboard an aircraft carrier. The aircraft that we're riding on is a 10-passenger transport. It's called a COD. That stands for Carrier Onboard Delivery. But it might as well be called Crash-On Delivery. You see, planes don't exactly land on an aircraft carrier. A touchdown is called a trap. And you'll see why in just a minute here. Incredible bone-crunching roar of jet engines surrounds you. It annihilates your hearing the minute you step on deck. To even begin to understand its intensity, turn your TV setup to full volume. Then imagine a noise 100 times as loud, penetrating your cranium from all directions. Don't bother to adjust the picture, though. Those lines in your set are caused by the sweep of the ship's radar on any nearby television equipment. At first, you are completely disoriented. Moments ago, from the air, the America seemed small, ridiculously small. Who in their right mind would land an airplane on this speck in the middle of the ocean? But on deck, its size overwhelms you. 5 acres of greasy, rolling, pitching pavement move up and down under your feet. It's as long as 3.5 football fields, as wide as the Potomac River. From top to bottom, the America has 18 decks and miles of passageways. Imagine the Empire State Building laid on its side and try walking from top to bottom.
But if you really want to get an idea of the size of this place, just try walking the passageways. You'll quickly get the idea.
Above deck, the America is an international airfield. Here below, she is home for 5,000 men, a city afloat. Those 5,000 sailors can manage to eat 18,000 meals a day in the America's 7 mess halls and wardrooms. So the America, like all cities her size, has her own butcher shop and bakery, along with her own police force, a post office, a hospital, and a mayor, Captain Sam Leeds. She also has her own TV station with its own evening news.
The president-elect is planning to meet with several of the nation's black leaders, many of whom...
The USS America may have the same population as Capitol Heights, Maryland, but there are some differences in the two cities. Public transportation? Sure. Feet. Women? None. Not even one. And then there's the noise. What was that?
That was an airplane taking off. What that was. It makes a little bit of noise. You ought to try sleeping with that over there.
And day and night, those rumblings can be heard throughout the ship. From our relatively luxurious quarters, all the way to the shop that features the latest in jeans fashions, located some 5 levels below the flight deck.
But it's not a city of luxuries. It's a life filled with hardships that most of us cannot even begin to imagine. Yes, the America is huge, but the flight deck is off limits to anyone off duty. Too noisy, too dangerous. And below decks, she is just a huge box filled with machinery, supplies, and 5,000 men who have nowhere to go.
Well, a lot of people kind of define being on a carrier like being in prison, only you got a chance of drowning.
Actually, it's not as Spartan as one might imagine. Once you've been aboard for just several weeks, you quickly become acclimated to it. But the routine is work, work, work.
When she is at sea, an aircraft carrier operates 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for months at a time. 16-hour days are not uncommon here. 12-hour days are routine. And often, especially on the flight deck, the work is dangerous.
The work's very interesting, you know. It's quite dangerous up there on the flight deck. You have to keep heads up at all times, you know. That's just the way the job is.
So they work, and then they sing, or play, or watch tape TV, or in grand military tradition, they gripe about the hardships of life at sea. They'll gladly tell you what they don't like about it.
It's too big, too many things happening, and definitely too many people on board. You know, it gets tiresome after a few years of waiting in line for for everything, literally everything, sometimes to take a shower at night.
It's a big ship, but you feel isolated because you're out in the middle of the water. There's no no way to get off, really. You feel kind of trapped.
It depends on, you know, what kind of attitude you have. I mean, like they say, you have good times and you have bad times. You know, you just got to deal with it, that's all.
But it isn't easy dealing with the complete lack of privacy. These are the enlisted men's quarters. Each sailor is allotted one rack, 3.5 feet by 3.5 feet by 7 feet. They'll tell you it's just the size of a coffin.
Well, there's only a small rack, you know, that's the only place you really get privacy. They say a man's rack is his kingdom.
Well, the only privacy you really get, though, is when you're sleeping. That's about the only time that you're really alone.
Life at sea is hard, but there are good times, too.
Pulling into port, that is the best time. When you pull into port, hit the gangway or the brow, whatever you want to call it, go up to the bar and order a beer, and it's nice and good. It really was.
We do the boats. All of us right here, we're on boat space. When you see your boat come out good, you know, knowing that you did it, and it goes in water, and that's right, and you're driving it.
All right.
So that's pretty good.
America. Hi, I'm Henry Tenenbaum. We're aboard the aircraft carrier America, located in the Atlantic Ocean off Norfolk, Virginia. Can you imagine what it's like to be catapulted off an aircraft carrier? Watch this. In our first story, we'll explore life on the flight deck of an aircraft carrier. What does it take to land an airplane on a rocking, rolling mobile runway? Welcome aboard! It's one thing to take off from a typical airport runway, thousands of feet long. This is the catapult on an aircraft carrier, a strip just a few hundred feet in length. It ends abruptly in the ocean. Hooked to a giant steam cannon beneath the deck, the huge fighter and its crew are hurled off the edge.
It's like the best ride you ever got at Disneyland. Within about a second, you're going down 250, 300 feet of catapult track, and you're accelerating from zero to about 165 knots. It's a very good ride.
Lieutenant Commander John Carrier has catapulted off the America dozens of times. He grew up in Alexandria, Virginia, knowing he wanted to be a pilot, but he didn't lose his heart to fighters until he was 18 years old.
I had an opportunity to ride in the back seat of a TA-4, which is the standard advanced trainer we have here, and I was dazzled. I mean, here's this little non-performance airplane, at least in my mind, and it was just great. I thought, wow, if that's that much fun, think of what it'd be like to fly a fighter. And at that point, I knew I wanted to fly fighters, and I went for it.
3 years and $1 million worth of training later, John Carrier catapulted off the deck of an aircraft carrier for the very first time. Almost 70 years earlier, Hampton Roads, Virginia, a man named Eugene Eli also catapulted off a carrier for the first time. Well, he didn't exactly catapult, and it wasn't exactly a carrier. It was a wooden platform built over the bow of a cruiser. But he made it, and naval aviation was born. Today, USS America is one of 13 carriers in the fleet. With 90 airplanes aboard, she is a huge mobile weapon. the range and versatility that is remarkable, Captain Sam Leeds explains.
We can take our airfield here 1,000 miles in 2 days easily and literally operate in a different part of the world. It has a lot of advantages, and whatever the wind condition is, we can just turn for it and take advantage of the conditions we're in. With the new aircraft we have, we can operate in most weather conditions.
Keeping this giant airfield afloat takes the combined efforts of 5,000 men. Working 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, there's no time off for good behavior and no margin for error.
You have no time for mistakes up here, and they have to always be alert. You know, you have a lot of hazard or jet intake, exhaust. You know, you can get easily blown off the ship if you don't know what you're doing.
There are many ways to die on a flight deck. Every 30 seconds, an aircraft is shooting off the side of the ship like a bullet. Another is dropping onto the ship in what is euphemistically referred to as a trap. For the men who work on deck, the danger of being blown off, sucked in, or run over by a 25-ton airplane is a very real one. But in spite of the danger, the men we talk to enjoy their flight deck jobs.
It's great. I love it. I think it's very exciting myself. Now, I don't mind being up here, landing airplanes. It's pretty exciting.
If takeoffs look traumatic, landings appear positively suicidal.
Sir, of course, sir.
The sequence goes something like this. Your job is to land the airplane. Up on the bridge, the captain's job is to get and keep this mobile runway in position, smooth and headed into the wind.
So 360 on Intruder.
On the ball, 502.
This is one deck below the bridge. It's called primary, like an air traffic control tower. It's in charge of takeoff and landing sequence.
Hold it! Hold it!
And this is the landing service officer working on deck. His job is to visually check your descent, ensure you're on course, and to let you know the runway is clear and ready for your trap. A so-called foul deck means the runway isn't quite ready for landing. Maybe the plane that landed 45 seconds ago isn't completely clear of the runway, or the cable isn't in place, or maybe there's a person in the way. Up in the air, your approach may be perfect, but if there's still a foul deck 5 seconds before touchdown, you'll be waved off and sent around again. If and when everything checks out, the LSO will clear you to land.
Clear deck! Clear deck!
A small hook on the back of a plummeting plane is supposed to snag one of the cables strung across the deck. That's supposed to stop the airplane. The pilot lands with engines roaring full throttle, so that if he misses the cable, he can get the plane back in the air. It's like parking a car by smashing full speed into the car in front of you. An awesome experience, as any brand new carrier pilot will tell you.
It's really kind of hard to say, but it's really a lot of excitement's going on, and you know, you're looking at the deck and you're looking at your alignment, you know, making sure you're coming down in the right attitude, making sure everything's secure in the cockpit, and then all of a sudden you just come across, you know, it's water, steel. The hook, you know, catches the wire and the plane stops, and you kind of lunge forward, and it's just, you know, fantastic. It's really.
We've been on board the carrier for 2 days, and it's still hard to understand why a rational human being would choose to be slung into space and trapped back onto a steel slab speck in the middle of the ocean. What motivates them? Why do they do it?
It sounds a little corny, but I think I do it because of Mom, the girl next door, and apple pie. That's a cliche at best, but still it pretty well sums up what goes on, I think. And that's true of a lot of people. I believe, and this is a very idealistic thing, that my goal in life as a fighter pilot is to make my job obsolete. Wouldn't it be nice?